The moon is so high and round. The moon tonight. I just went to Safeway, and the moon is so huge. And whenever I see a huge full moon, and it wasn't high. It was low. It was like almost just over the lake, Lake Washington. Just a magnificent sight. And whenever I see that, I think of the thing in the moonlight. So I'm going to talk. Well, before I talk about the theme of the moonlight, I think I am actually going to read from my newest book, just written book last year, Some Unknown Gulf of Night, which is a prose poem vignette sequence inspired by H.P. Lovecraft's Fungi from YUGGOTH. And this is part ...34, which is inspired by Lovecraft's sonnet number 34, which I'm this reading is my comment on the sonnets, which are superbly written here by Will Hart on his Kruhuruhu 1. So this is my reaction to that sonnet, but it is also an example of how H.P. Lovecraft's The Thing in the Moonlight has inspired my own fiction. I examined the dead city as our raft drifted down the gaunt canal, and did not like the way its outline suggested awful things that one may witness in disease dreaming. One could not believe that such a place was inhabited, and yet there came from some place deep within a sound of muffled and monotonous drumming, deliberate and persistent. I could just see, beyond the filthy fog that hovered over the decaying towers of the metropolis, the expiring orb of day sinking in the darkening sky. Our raft was sailing slowly, and yet it disturbed me to see Bobby standing boldly near its edge, holding on to nothing but the enormous grimoire that he had found in an antique shop somewhere in the necrotic megalopolis. We had almost reached the city's end when I beheld the stone bridge ahead of us that spanned the gaunt canal. I thought that the dark figure who stood at the center of that bridge was waving at us, but as our craft neared her, I saw that she was gesturing to the risen moon, and it disturbed me, as we approached the bridge, to see Bobby raise one hand and imitate the dark woman's motion. I peeked to where her face should have been, but all I could discern was undulating shadow beneath the length of rich red hair, and then she was blocked out by the rotting stone with which the antediluvian bridge had been erected. The city was behind us, and gradually our craft drifted more slowly still until it floated to an outcropping of rocks and stopped. I marveled at how my young friend hopped nonchalantly onto those slippery rocks and climbed their little height to solid ground. Cautiously, I rose to a standing position on the gently bobbing raft and gingerly stepped onto one flat rock. And as I balanced myself on the stony surface, the raft behind me moved away, re-entering the black canal and drifting from us down the oily water. "I don't care for this weird trek you've proposed, Bobby," I informed him. "You told me that we were going to visit a haunt of spectral dream such as I experienced during last night's slumber. Thus far, this is nothing like my delicious nightmare. Why have you brought that cumbersome tome? Why you've brought that cumbersome tome is quite beyond me." It was then that the little imp turned to me and smiled as he had never smiled before, and he opened the heavy book so that its sheets of parchment were illuminated by beams of moonlight. I could not decipher the words that had been etched thereon in minute script, and to stare at it oppressed me with headache and dizziness. I had of late been plagued with an unaccustomed ocular trouble which prevented me from reading fine print. And as I peered at the page, I experienced a renewed tugging of nerves and facial muscle. "Look here, Howard," he squeaked. This is an elaborate description of the way to our desired destination, a diagram of language. It's easily deciphered. Come on, old man, follow me.
Turn the page.
Come on. He scampered ahead of me, almost skipping, as I limped after him along the way that led down a dark, half-wooded heath where boulders wore patches of phosphorescent moss. I followed the young creature, who was impelled by some obscure sense of quest, until we came to a dark and seemingly familiar woodland, into which we walked. Time passed, and at last we came upon a miasmic swamp, which seemed to excite my friend. Pointing to an alien-featured tree across the floated quagmire, he yelled, "There! We need to stand before that tree!" He studied the squalid water, and then, to my astonishment, walked into it, laughing at my yelp of caution. When I saw that he did not sink into the depths, I approached the dank surface and saw the path of large, flat stones on which my friend was walking. "Are you coming, Howard?" he called. And so I timidly stepped onto one flat rock and held out my arms in an attempt to balance myself as I followed Bobby across the water. Yet the rocks, large as they were slippery with slime, and just as I had almost reached the other side, I lost my foothold and fell into thick water. Bobby, standing on the grassy ground, shook his head as if I were some pathetic clown, and then he set down his book and offered me his hands, which I took as he pulled me out of the swamp. How strange that other hands beneath the surface, phantasmal and determined, seemed to try to hold on to my ankles and drag me into the nadir of foul water. Bobby helped me to the solid ground, on which I dripped. "You're a damn mess," he sadly informed me, and then he seemed to completely forget my existence as he turned to an unfamiliar tree, to the unfamiliar tree, and touched a hand to one of the black spheres that was attached to a low branch. Why on earth did he begin to hum to that queer object, and why did his humming sound so unnatural? How curiously he bent to that black sphere and touched it with his mouth. I began to step toward him and foolishly trod upon his monstrous book, the binding of which was warm and wet. Bending to pick it up, I was appalled to see that the hide that served as binding seemed to be perspiring, which caused a cry of disgust to escape my mouth. My noise caught Bobby's attention, and he filtered to me with drowsy motion and relieved me of my burden. "We're almost there now," he pronounced as he chewed upon the black flesh of the sphere into which he had eaten. I did not like the alteration in his intonation, how it was laced with a kind of buzzing articulation. Nor did I like the way his mouth had widened when he smiled. "I have devoured knowledge and can show you your habitat of vision. Follow me." Although wearied of the game of follow the leader, I held my tongue and moved my feet, my legs weighed down by the heavy fabric of my soggy suit. Eventually we emerged from the woods upon a tableland of moss-grown rock lit by faint moonlight, and something about the place did indeed seem familiar. Even more recognizable were the rusty tracks of a street railway, which we followed until we came upon a yellow vestibule car such as I had discovered in my unfathomable dream. It was untenanted as in my dream, and we cautiously boarded it. Bobby, before me, had opened the tome and was reading from it in his peculiar buzzing drone, and the snatches of formula that he uttered aloud were so frightful that I begged him to stop. He turned to me and revealed the monstrous malformation of his face, which was now a mere white cone tapering to one blood-red tentacle. My mouth was frozen with terror, and I could not understand why his clothes were as drenched as my own, or why the heavy book was in my grasp. Feeling faint, I staggered forward toward the archway, in which the outer figure stumbled until his visage touched my own. Howling bestially, I plunged into and through the yielding door of glass, the shards of which ripped my atrocious visage from me. Blind and idiotic, I stomped on the floor of our temporary globe, the blasphemous book pressed against my breast, and I raised my facelessness to the cold and primal stars. So there is an example of how the thing in the moonlight continues to infiltrate my imagination as a weird fantasist. I was trying to find the most recent printing of the thing in the moonlight, because S.T. Joshi has removed it from all of his editions of H.P. Lovecraft. There's a really great, I don't know if I can find it now, I think all of my papers have fallen on the floor. Hang on. Ah, here it is. This is from the Lovecraft Archive. This is great, because this here, where is it? This is the letter to Donald Wandre that was used for the text of The Thing in the Moonlight. And this is The Thing in the Moonlight, with the paragraphs that were added by J. Chapman Miskey, who published it first in 1941 in his magazine Bazaar. The first book publication of The Thing in the Moonlight was in this Arkham House book, Dreams and Fancies. See if I can find it. And this book is supposedly a collection of those works by Lovecraft that were inspired by his dreams. in regular mass market paperbacks, the story can be found in The Tomb, which is published by Valentine and Del Rey, and it's near the back, where it is in a section called Fragments. Where is it? Yeah, it's four fragments. And it is, this is a great little collection, actually. So there it is. And then I just discovered that it was published in this might be its most recent publication. This was from 2005. This is the Del Rey. They did two of these. Mass paperback anthologies of H.P. Lovecraft. I thought they were going to do a third, but they never did it. This has a great, where is it? This has a great introduction by Harlan Ellison, a man whom I adore. He was very nice to me when I met him at the Nebulas, when the Nebulas came. And there is the story. So, and Robert M. Price, who has edited a five-volume edition of the fiction of H.P. Lovecraft that will be published by Centipede Press, will include The Thing in the Moonlight in that. So, bravo, Bob. Okay, darlings, that's it. I'm going to do some reading, and I